will put it on silence, we would appreciate it. However, they have a mind of their own. If it does ring, if you go outside and answer it, and you come back in, and we won't wait on you, but we'll continue the meeting. I would like to thank, and I know I'm gonna miss some, the media that has showed up. And without calling names, we certainly appreciate y'all being here. We certainly appreciate each and every one of y'all, you know, being here, that's from the public sector. I'm gonna follow a format that we normally do with the Bulloch County Commissioners. And there's one thing that we're gonna leave out today, simply because we're gonna talk about a lot of things that we have not heard about. And we're gonna leave out public comments for this meeting. We'll have another meeting scheduled probably February the 28th, and then we can get public comment worked in, into that. I'm now gonna call on Mayor McCollum, if he will, to give a welcome and some opening statement.
Thank you, Commissioner Thompson. We want to give welcome to everybody that's here. I want to acknowledge the fact that this is a great moment for us. And so I do want to make a statement before we begin the meeting. And the statement is as follows. We want to thank the county for hosting this joint meeting. We're super excited for all the things that we've done in the past and continuing to do. And the message that I want to continue to spread is that it's been great over my tenure the past 5 years working with the county. I know sometimes there's a narrative that's put out as far as the county and the city not getting along, but I want to be clear that I wouldn't want to work with a better group of people. Many of these people that's to my right hand side, I've known them since I was a child in this community, and I have nothing but respect for them. And I want to acknowledge all the work that we've been able to do as a collaborative body. That's everything from working on the industrial site that we now named after Bruce Yard. The things that we've done as far as the tags on the out at the center of the city and the outskirts, where we're seeing our new publics coming in. And then we have two great businesses that's coming in. Aiden and Aspen Energy, that's gonna be about roughly 1,000 brand new jobs for Bulloch County. And those things would not be possible if it was not us being able to work together and us working for the greater good of not just the city of Statesboro and its people, but the people and citizens of Bulloch County. So I want to say on behalf of the city to the county, thank y'all for everything that y'all been to us and the great partners that you guys have been. With that being said, we're going to turn it back over to our chair and continue with the meeting.
And I would get those comments, and then we can close the meeting now. but gonna now ask you to stand if you will, and we're gonna have the invocation and pledge of allegiance by the mission.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the many blessings you give us every day in this day, Lord. Thank you for watching over us, Lord. I pray that you'll continue to watch over us and bless this body of service that we are assembled here, Lord. Bless everyone that is in attendance and every family represented, Lord. I pray that we will make decisions that are pleasing to you, Lord, and that we can build forth in the things that you want us to do. Ask for all these things in your son Jesus, that's what we pray this morning. Amen. Join me in the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good afternoon. I, Venus Nancy White, present as clerk of the board of commissioners of Bulloch County, hereby call the roll for those governing body. All those present shall answer by saying aye. Chairman Roy Thompson.
Aye.
Vice Chairman Timmy Rushing.
Aye.
Commissioner Ray Mosley.
Aye.
Commissioner Walt Gibson.
Aye.
Commissioner Kurt Deal.
Aye.
Commissioner Jackie Stringer.
Aye.
And Commissioner Anthony Simmons. I have determined that we have six members of the board of commissioners present. Therefore, we have a quorum to conduct business for the good of the citizens of Bulloch County. And I yield the floor back to the chairman.
Thank you very much. And this afternoon, we have two gentlemen that are going to give presentations. One will give one and one will give two, but there's several components in those presentations. So we're going to start off with our county manager, Tom Couch. And Couch, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Mayor, councilors, and commissioners. I think that this is a very important moment in our time. I've been fortunate to have probably a very good relationship with City Manager Pennant, and we've had numerous informal and informal discussions about the future of our community. And ultimately, I think this led to us getting together and saying it's finally time that our governing bodies get together. And we don't do it frequently enough as we should, but I think we've got a strong common purpose to do so in the future, and not just for the sake of what we're talking about today, but infinitely we hope, because we all know that our community is going to experience some change. And in that regard, the presentation that I intend to give, commissioners will have to be patient because they've probably seen it a couple of times, although I've tried to modify it for brevity. I think City Manager Penny has been exposed to similar information that I've shared with him, but it may be the first time that those members of council who are present today have heard it. So we'll go through it, and if there's any questions or Q&A at the end that we want to go through, we certainly encourage that, and then I think we'll just proceed with the meeting accordingly. Let's check out my text skills here. Okay, the primary topics in this presentation concern what we believe will be the ultimate funding impact. We'll talk very briefly about land use in our present zoning moratorium, and then of course our plans for water and sewer, because they really do tie in and overlap with each other. Oh goodness, I honestly don't know who planned this. I personally feel that it's an affront, and when I find out the person who did it, I'll take immediate. But sadly, in front of my family, at the end of this game, when they finally put the flag on in the middle of the Big O, I said, this is the greatest game of my life, and my three children and wife were subsequently insulted.
So you have a Georgia Southern picture of them now?
That'll be in the next presentation. But my congratulations to Georgia Southern. Anytime you beat App State, I think that's a good thing, and I've been doing that. Makes me glad to always come back to Statesboro. Okay, just talking about the funding impact a little bit. I don't know how visible this is going to be with the lighting and for those in the back of the audience, but very briefly, there's four main components. We know we're going to have population growth, and not just in Southeast Bulloch, and I'll be able to illustrate in a couple of minutes that it's really going to be countywide, but there is probably going to be a significant concentration in Southeast Bulloch, because geographically it has what I call this binary balance. It's sort of a ground zero point for workforce housing, and a lot of the attractiveness to it is that it sort of has virgin lands there for development. And we all know that Southeast Bulloch is very wet, and it has geological and environmental sensitivities there, which we're trying to be conscientious of as we go forward in planning. But we do have an expectation of workforce housing. We think there's an excellent chance in Census Tract 1109, which is the very lower end of Southeast Bulloch County, that we'll have at least 5,000 people of undeveloped growth, and that would indicate that we need approximately 2,000 housing units of some sort of density. So you have the combination of population and workforce housing, but we have to keep in mind with regard to the economic growth, it's not just Hyundai siting in North Bryan County. We've already learned that there have been at least two announcements, one in Bulloch County, of significant tier one suppliers, Ajin here in Bulloch County, and Hyundai Mobis, I think, just announced in Bryan County on the Richmond Hill side on it came out yesterday or over the weekend. So that's just the beginning. There are several tier one suppliers that can still yet locate here in the region, and we expect to get our share here. But if you look at various case studies of what went on in West Georgia and Central Alabama when Kia and Hyundai located in those areas, it creates another ripple effect where you get a lot of new businesses and support services that you're going to need throughout the community and throughout the region. It's going to be a tremendous opportunity for small business creation, job creation, and growth in various business sectors. And then we can't leave out the land use and infrastructure, because Southeast Bulloch as a whole, that I'll show on a map in a minute, is very large geographically. So I've had the opportunity to say to the commissioners and some community members, as vast as Southeast Bulloch is, if you want to call it Burkhalter Road South or Langston Chapel South, or maybe even Gashiel Road South and going toward the county line and the river, it consists of hundreds of square miles. But I think our concentration needs to be south of Brooklyn, south of Stilson. And as I'll show in a couple minutes, we have a couple of defined areas that we're looking at in terms of a growth boundary or potential wet utility district. But I also have to say that, again, speaking with Mr. Penny and speaking in the broader sense of what needs to be done community-wide, it's bigger than water and sewer infrastructure, particularly when you get out into the rural areas of the county that have the prospects for growth. That's going to put pressure on all kinds of services and road infrastructure as well, the need for new facilities. And even in the city of Statesboro, the city is an epicenter of economic growth and the institutions here. If you consider the Beach Tech, Georgia Southern University, the public school systems and its footprint here, Statesboro is going to get more than its share of growth, but for the purposes of this presentation, our focus is to lean in a little bit more on water and sewer infrastructure and share what are currently our preliminary plans. But I think trying to do a graphic like this hopefully will help you understand of what we're trying to lean into. We use a lot of different assumptions. We use seven different statistical methods that could measure growth countywide and within the particular census tract, lower south, Southeast Bulloch, which traditionally has been called the Neville-Stilson census tract or census area or census civil division. If you're a planner, you get a little geeky with some of these names and acronyms. But in addition to trying to use some statistical methods to project future population growth, we did some scenario planning where we looked at net growth, migration, and employment patterns in two different areas, one around Kia, the Kia plant in West Point, It's a 10-county area that includes some counties in both West Georgia and East Alabama, and then a 4-county area around the Honeydew plant in Montgomery, Alabama, actually in their metropolitan statistical area. And just to give you a frame of reference, Honeydew is projected on site in Bryan County to produce 8,100 jobs. Back in 2003 or 5, I think Honeydew in Montgomery, we were told maybe would produce around 3,000, but they're up to like 3,800. And then in 2009, when Kia came to West Point, Georgia, I think they initially began with 2,700, but now they're launching over 3,000, and everybody along that I-85 corridor going to Montgomery, there's just a great proliferation of suppliers that serve both Kia and Hyundai, which interestingly, I find out that in North America, they actually sort of compete against each other in a happy way, right, Benji? Yeah. So happy if you're making money. We try to be very deliberative and conservative, really, in looking at what population growth may look like. And as you can see, in lower southeast Bulloch County, we still have that 5,000 figure that we were talking about in the last graphic. We think the balance of the county outside of that census tract will grow by over 12,000 people. You know, in the bigger picture, we'll probably go from 81,000 to about 98 to 103,000 by 2030. And it really depends on how fast this Hyundai growth occurs. But otherwise, we would probably be at 93,000, which is a typical or normal growth for what we have in Bulloch County going back to 1978. So I think it's important to understand some of these assumptions and projections. And actually, when we ran the different statistical projections, the growth rate could go from, you know, 1 to 23,000 and 1,000 to 23,000 in that census tract, which is why we tried to do some scenario planning and really do some counts with some other regions with Kia and Hyundai had their population and economic impact. Very briefly, on the land use and zoning moratorium, you know, that does tie into this. There were several purposes for it. Unincorporated Bulloch County was growing anyway. We were getting very vocal opposition at rezoning hearings held for new residential development that encroached really the deeper residential areas of Bulloch County that we neither had the services or infrastructure to accommodate. As I already said, Southeast Bulloch, particularly lower Southeast Bulloch, is ground zero for new Hyundai workforce housing units. And we are seeing a substantial amount of interest in development prospects along the I-16 or old SR-46 corridor, which is in this concentrated area. I'll show you the map. I think with the announcement of Ogden and perhaps with subsequent announcements to come, it's going to become even more attractive. And I can tell you from the get-go, when the state, along with the JDA, made the purchase of the land at the mega site and made it available for the public, really, in terms of the state to develop, we knew something that was going to happen well over a year ago. Right about the time that this occurred, you could argue we going back as far as Volvo. So even before we knew that Hyundai was going to be a thing, we said, we've really got to think about what we're doing. So, you know, this isn't something that we just came up with, you know, yesterday. You know, we've been thinking about it for well over a year. Naturally, what we want to do is balance all the interests, and that's what we're trying to do by having formed a stakeholders committee. We want to direct the growth and development into an area where there's adequate planned infrastructure. We don't want to have leapfrog development that creates bulk sprawl. You know, we don't want to have what I call a measles map for half-acre lot subdivisions. So we have to keep that in mind as far as our objectives are concerned. And then, which is kind of a moniker of Hyundai Rising, as I like to call it, speed to market, Southeast Bulloch, Statesboro, the whole region. We're going to grow at the same pace, but Hyundai facility is prepared to be open on January 1st, 2025, which is their objective. We've got 2 years to keep the pace and really be speed to market in terms of infrastructure and growth management. And very briefly, you know, we're trying to work our way through the moratorium period, which is projected to end at 6 months in mid-February, which I have to confess to the leaders. I'm very nervous, but, you know, nothing that, you know, you gotta be like Jim Harbaugh, a jackhammer, you know, you work through holidays, you know, take vacation, you know, you get sick, you just work it through and we're gonna get through it. Now, the moratorium does not affect the rest of unincorporated Bulloch County outside of a map I'll show you in a minute. And there were applications that were accepted before August 16th in Southeast Bulloch, which I think we've kind of flushed out for now. But the other thing to recognize is we only did a residential zoning moratorium, and we didn't do it among other commercial and industrial land uses, but we really don't see a lot of that happening or a lot of demand for that because the infrastructure is not in place. All right, and this is just a moratorium map, and if you can, I want you to just kind of keep an image of this in your mind. It really does go from Burkholder Road south to the county line. I can't really remember if it wraps around Nettles, but it gets pretty close to Nettles. But otherwise, it goes back down to the river and the county line. And we felt like we needed to capture that area to have moratorium geographically, because where I mentioned measles maps, we wanted to hold any demand that there was for any kind of subdivision development that could occur out in that area until we could get our heads wrapped around trying to fix our development ordinances, or at least fix them up to a modern level. And I won't do karaoke, but we do have a steering committee. They're represented by the different kinds of folks, and there's a little bit of alphabet soup there. So, three commissioners from the Board of Commissioners, two Planning and Zoning Commission members, two Southeast Bulloch citizens that primarily represent the agricultural community, which is a big stakeholder in that part of the county, our school superintendent Charles Wilson and Mr. Thompson from the Development Authority of Bulloch County, which we needed someone with economic development or street cred, because another component of what we're trying to do is we're trying to change, or not change, but amend our future development map in our comprehensive plan. And currently we don't have any developers on the committee, but as we advance with our initiative on the moratorium, we are going to start to bring them in, because they are stakeholders too. We just wanted to cut down on any potential, you know, drag on the meetings that we would have with the steering committee. We didn't want there to be any night fights if there was any kind of anti-growth sentiment among anyone on the committee, which I don't think there is, but we know that there is anti-growth sentiment out in the community. And I won't repeat all this, I've kind of gone through it. The main thing we want to do is update our future development map, update our zoning and development related codes. You know, we use a lot of zoning conditions, and that just means we have crappy ordinances, and we need to embed some of those conditions in the ordinance. But we also need to reflect new trends in construction, different types of land uses. I mean, one thing we need to look at, and we are looking at in the context of it, especially with Hyundai coming, electronic vehicles. You know, there's going to be more things like charging stations and other EV infrastructure that we have to look through a lens with zoning. And then, of course, we want to align the policies and the design principles of our comprehensive plan with our ordinances as well. And ultimately, as I've already said, this goes hand in hand with planning infrastructure. I won't go through the action calendar, but suffice it to say that we're getting close, where we're going to have to meet with some of our stakeholders who are a little more wonky on zoning and subdivision regulations, because it won't be long before we're having to push those changes that we need to make goal in the end is still to try to be completed by mid-February. Okay, water and sewer, which is the main topic, I think I had to build all the other intervening variables into the discussion. Okay, now, when you look at that map, it's very hard to see, but you may, if mid-map, if you will, and just below the blue area to the right, there's a line, it's the Bulloch Bryan County line. But if you look at that map geographically, and it's difficult at this scale and from your angles, but it basically goes from the county line and Eldora Road westward and crosses over 67, that would be east to west. North to south, it roughly goes from Mud Road down to I-16. Now this boundary, as we stated to the steering committee at the outset, it isn't in stone. We may make adjustments, but that same map that I'll show you in a subsequent map coming up, whatever we do with this map, we want to make sure it aligns with changes or an amendment we're going to make with the future development map, because that goes back into zoning and making development decisions as well. But the idea is, if you look at the broader census tract, the census tract actually goes a little further north on the boundary to Stilson and out to the river, and out west toward Nettles. So what we're strategically trying to do, and the county commissioners are going to, and planning and zoning commissioners are going to be, have to be very, very disciplined in making decisions about future development. Because if we're going to pour millions of dollars into water and sewer infrastructure, into that blue flume, or a rough representation of it, then development needs to be directed where you have municipal type utilities that are up to a higher standard, which would be very similar or identical to what we have in Statesboro. And there's still a lot of policy and ordinance decisions that have to go into this that we have to really get started on before we put pipes in the ground and such. Oh, and I forgot to mention that little pink area, if you will, probably not identifying it as the right color, but that is the location of where Hyundai is going to be. So you can see as the crow flies, that area of the county is very close, and it's reasonably easy commuting at this point, and probably to some degree in the future, but you can get to work pretty quickly by coming from that portion of Bulloch County, although, you know, people are going to be dispersed throughout the region. And then, just to sort of match it up, it's a little hard to see on the left-hand side, but one of the big representations with the map on the left, which is our future development map, that big yellow area around Statesboro, you could consider it sort of an urban or suburban growth boundary, but really it's a character area where we have tried in the last several years to concentrate growth and development outside the city of Statesboro. And ultimately, what we would do with the area in blue with the map on the right-hand side, we would overlay that area into the appropriate part of the map on the left to be what we think will be a similar, we call it in our land use plan or comprehensive plan, character area, typically a suburban neighborhood or a suburban corridor, because you might see little red lines coming out of Statesboro along 67 and 80 and such. That represents where we would put more commercial type development. So ultimately, that's how all that would overlap and how the utility district and the land use plan would tie together. Okay, obviously that area is unserved by water and wastewater facilities. We've also relied on data and information that we produced in 2018 by Georgia Southern and some partners here at Grant. They produced the Black Creek Watershed Management Plan. And among various recommendations, they recommended the prospect of sanitary sewer, in part to help combat failing septic tanks, which in turn, if they fail, they pollute the watershed. We also had a customer base. We were projecting by 2030, or probably before, of 2,000 customers on water, nearly, and there were 1,500 on sewer, depending on how fast we would lay the infrastructure down. And I'll show you a map, and has some lines and tanks and well sites. But this is the water, and if all of our funding comes through, we probably, and this is very preliminary, this is subject to change, but and I think it could be very well, because we have a land use consultant working with our civil engineer, and they're doing an assessment right now. So just like the blue zoned area in that map, these lines could change as quickly as that map could. But that is a fair representation of where water service could occur. And just so you can tell on the map, that blue line area, it's just above I-16. It's down around exit 137 and 132. And then it does, these lines do sort of a loop around 119 spur and coming back down 80. But that map could flip very easily, and we could cut back going down 80, and we could actually go up our Polo Road or go further west on 46. It's yet to be determined. It's all very preliminary, but it's just a snapshot of what we're looking at right now. Along with sewer, we're actually going to get an intergovernmental agreement up to half million gallon a day of capacity from Bryan County. Bryan County has to build a wastewater plant and supply company. And it's going to be an 8 million gallon plant, and they figure about using 4 to 4.5 million gallons a day, and they've agreed to an allocation up to half a million a day for Southeast Bulloch. And then we're going to use our leverage funds, whether it's through ARPA or other funds that we apply for, or if we have to use some kind of debt to build out the lines, sewer lines from the county line and the water infrastructure, of course, within the area that we determine. And one thing we have to look at is additional long-term capacity, because we believe with the amount of sewer that we would get from Bryan County, it would be a little bit difficult to go west of Arcola Road. So that may have been one of two questions, whether we build a wastewater plant on our own, which I'm not really a big fan of, because when we talk about signing a wastewater plant, not just in Georgia, but anywhere, it's not a great way to make friends and influence people. If you have to have big buffers, and if you're going to do a spray field in particular, instead of discharge, you have to have this amount of land. So, you know, a thought would be is to purchase capacity from the city of Statesboro if it is available or will become available. But if that doesn't happen, then I think we have to reconsider and consider building some kind of smaller wastewater treatment facility, maybe somewhere in the area between 1 and 3 million gallons a day. I really can't see it's going any higher than that, but you know, that's something for the engineers and scientists to figure out. And then in the map I'm going to show you, there's about 9 miles of lines and 3 pump stations at this point, and the area stretches from Eldora Road to what we call the Bay District, which is nearly on the Cola Road. We've got some things that we're going to have to do. We have to have mandatory hookup thresholds. We have to consider allowing decentralized sewer and some decommissioning until centralized sewer is available. But ultimately, developers would have to purchase capacity for our county's proposed new sewer plant, or in ours, if we have to build them, or in Statesboro's, through developer agreements, whether it's through capital recovery fees, ATCs, or impact fees. It's all the same thing. It's really all directed toward capital recovery. That's just a very brief rendition of what we're looking at on the sewer side, but again, it's not set in stone. And our capital stack right now is a little short of $8 million. ARPA funding, we've applied for state ARPA, almost $10 million. We have a CDS, or federal earmark, that's looking favorable right now, depending on how the government does in their lame duck sessions with the federal budget. in spending continuation of CRs, but we're feeling pretty good about the CBS, which we would be directed towards sewer. We have determined other kinds of funding that we're going to use. I think over the next 6 months, we'll begin to figure that out. And then these are just some target dates that we want to get some of our work program initiatives done. I'd like to have our land use studies done on or before March 3rd of next year. Likewise, have a air and water and sewer ordinance. Perhaps have the preliminary engineering report done. And we hope they could turn it around fast enough. It's probably a little ambitious, but if nothing else, by summertime, I think we'd like to have a DDR, because again, if Monday needs to be up on January 1st, 2025, we need to be rising with them. And then, you know, you can read the rest of the initiatives yourself, but I think Monday has to be service first on January 1st of 2025, but ultimately, we need to be laying pipes in the ground well before that, and I think we would have to be complete with our construction of whatever we're doing just for a readiness level, probably by spring of 2025. So, outside of the building, the Michigan Wolverines being the Big Ten East Division champs, that's all I've got for today. And so if there's any questions or ideas or thoughts, I know I took you through a lot, but and I will of course offer these to Mr. Penny and the staff, so the council would like to look at them. I'm done.
Thank you. The mass that you identified, like the utility service, and I don't know, have y'all done an overlay? I know that it's one thing to see the maps here, but the maps don't really show a relationship to Statesboro and Bulloch County. Do you have one of the private, I don't know if you have one of this group. So we can really see, because it's sort of hard to.
I think in a previous presentation, I tried to overlay this blue area on top of the land use map. And then if you look at the land use map, the wider yellow area around Statesboro is an unincorporated area. And then further in, where I think it's no color or white, that's a representation of Statesboro city limits. So I think if we overlaid that blue area, it would probably come, again, basically from the county line and near the river, and it would come up on the road to the north and come back down to Brooklyn, Denmark. In fact, do you see that little, it's not,
do you have a curse on that at all?
Yeah. And you may be, I don't know how far you've been out in the county and meandered around, so to speak, but if you concentrate down at the I-16 and 67 area, and then you go up, there's a little star there, and that represents what they call the unincorporated Denmark community. And then and it's hard to tell, but if you carry a line, a northerly line that basically goes out to the river, and then you bring it back down to the county line and follow I-16, and it's really the same over on this map to the right too, except that blue area is not overlaid on that land use map. So really, you're from Denmark, unincorporated Denmark, you're probably a solid 8 or 9 miles from the city limits, and maybe about eight, or possibly a little less, depending upon how far you get that water and sewer out from the opposite view.
Where are you showing the land use? two of them will be Bulloch County, two will be Brown County, and...
Yes, you're referring to the four wells that are primarily in Sears County, right?
Right.
We haven't located them yet. Of course, we know they have to be as located as close to the plant as possible. And, but yes, they're, two of them will be owned by Brown County and two will be owned by Bulloch.
And from a operational standpoint, SDS, do we need to get that amended at all with Bulloch County? Do you have to amend the SDS agreement?
I think we have to make a minor technical amendment. I meant to read SDS this morning, but I didn't get a chance to. I think we've got to do it somehow on the sewer side. And I think what we may need to do, I know we've been going through a series of minor technical amendments with other things, but as I think we may be on the same schedule as far as a comprehensive plan update, although that may not, you know, create a major or mandatory SDS discussion. But whether it's, I wouldn't envision zeroing in on the SDS discussion until I think we're a little bit closer or more certain as to how we're going to form this district geographically. I think we're pretty close. I think we can do it within the next 6 months. Doesn't mean we can't be talking about it informally, but I think it will involve a minor amendment, and I think it has to do with sewer service. But I'll have to go back and read it to you.
I don't want to go into all the details of your presentation, Tom, but I do want to ask a pertinent question about the industrial parks that we have along 301. And would you say, or would you agree with this statement, I would say, that it's the collaboration with the city's water department, sewer utilities that ran down 301, that if it weren't for that collaboration and that agreement, we would not have the Bruce Yawn Park blowing up as it is. We would not have the TA, and we would not have the other two businesses that are coming along 301, not to mention increased interest along that corridor. Would you agree with that statement?
Okay, could you restate more personally?
That the county and the city working together to extend water and sewer and city utilities down that 301 corridor is the primary reason those industries are located at those locations, correct? Without the utilities, they don't locate there, correct?
At the time the agreement was made, and I would agree that it was one among several variables that made it work.
Okay, what I'm saying is these companies are coming now because the pipes are in the ground and the infrastructure is there. Mm-hmm. So my question is, if you, as you said, this isn't something we started yesterday, we've been thinking about this for a year, you could even say it goes back to Volvo, why wouldn't you have brought this to the city's attention before? And considering we're already in the water, sewer, and utilities business, why wouldn't the county have come to us and say, hey, let's partner in developing this area of our county where our community is, our city is, we're all city residents, we're all Bulloch County residents. So I'm curious why you would have negotiated with Bryan County before even coming to the city.
So are you saying that we should have?
Yes. So I'd like you to explain that strategy and that thinking, because sending sewer revenue to Bryan County is permanently sending revenue to Bryan County from Bulloch County residents that normally would stay here, go back into our coffers and pay for the services that we provide. Instead, we're going to be sending some of that money to Bryan County. I'd like you to explain that decision.
Well, I mean, would the city be willing to extend infrastructure 10, 15, to 17, to 20 miles?
We did it to 301.
Well, that's not nearly as far, and we're halfway there.
Well, don't you think we should have this discussion? You're asking me right now after you guys have already made plans.
Well,
seems a little late to be asking me now, isn't it?
Well, your tone seems rather punitive.
Well, it's irritated.
Yeah, punitive.
Okay.
I think we need to move on from this discussion.
All right.
So that we can.
So you don't have an answer to that question?
We can pick this up at a later time.
Okay.
Go to Mr. Penny's presentation and our presentations, and then I think it's something that we can all come back together on in the next meeting. Because a lot of this we heard for the first time ourselves.
Well, then it's your Penny where that money's going, Brian.
Penny, if you will go in here.
While Brian is getting us ready, I'm not as good as Tom, so I'm going to tell him. Must be a Michigan education.
I do. It's conference.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and to the members of the county commission. We actually presented to our city council, and Tom, he called me this event, I called him Mr. Couch. Mr. Couch was at our meeting back in August, and we felt that it was important for the city to look at our infrastructure as well. We know that we've been partners as Mr. Dorian spoke of with the Bouchon Commercial Park and the investment that the city made and the county in the collaboration to get the infrastructure to those locations. And so with the news of Hyundai coming to our community, a couple of things jump out very nicely laid out potential for growth as far as population is concerned. But what we like to also do is we want to be prepared as a community to have people locate to our community as well, Statesboro and Bulloch County, and take advantage of that. But we also want to be prepared. Our number one priority, and I think Benji would like this, is we need to make sure that in that industrial corridor, 301, that we don't have someone come and decide that they want to site a plant there, and we can't provide the infrastructure there. And we know that with Aspen Air Jail and Ogden going into the Bouchon Park, initially when Aspen Air Jail told us what their needs were going to be, it was possibly going to take up the capacity that was going to be needed at that location and at the Gateway Industrial Park. But as we have talked further, they didn't need as much. But at the same time, we want to be prepared because we don't want to lose an opportunity for our citizens to have more job opportunities in our community. But the other thing we also want to do, we want to be prepared for growth. And I know when we talk about growth in our community, it becomes somewhat a contentious issue. But we also have to recognize that growth is going to come. And so from a community standpoint, we can either plan for the growth or we can just let it happen organic. Our preference would be for us to plan for that growth so that we are prepared. We recognize in the last 12 months in Bulloch County and in Statesboro, on the multiple listings in our community, we probably had about 80 to 50 homes on MLS. And that, for people that might have an interest in moving into our community, is not a good place for our community to be. In the last 3 months, our city council has approved over 550 townhomes in the city limits of Statesboro. And we still have another five or so projects that will be coming to the planning board and eventually to our city council. We currently have one subdivision in the northern part of the city. I think it's the Fernhill subdivision. It's an 80-lot subdivision that was a part of our housing incentive program from the city that has already started moving dirt. And so we need those, we need that inventory in Statesboro and in Bulloch County. But today what we'd like, what I'd like to do is I'd like for the county to see the presentation that was shared with our city council at the August meeting. I'm gonna call upon, we wanna talk about our water infrastructure. We also wanna talk about our wastewater infrastructure. And then we wanna talk about gas infrastructure. Gas is important in Statesboro. I come from North Carolina originally, but in Statesboro, the good thing about our gas usage, it's not just a wintertime usage. When you can get year-round gas usage, that's a good customer. And Aspen Air General hopefully will be a good customer from a gas standpoint. So Chris Burke from Hudson Gayville is gonna come and he's gonna talk about our water system and wastewater system. He's gonna talk about the existing facilities. And then he's gonna talk about some potential expansion of the systems. And then after that, Steve Hotchkiss is going to, our public utilities director, is going to talk about our gas system and potential expansion of that as well. We're also going to share some numbers with you at the end. But today, we want to share information with you. We have some more work that we need to do, some more refinement that we need to discuss with our city council, and then we'll come back to you at that 90 days so period. And we talk a bit a little bit more firm on some proposed projects on how we move forward. So I'm calling Chris Brooks.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Chris Burke, with Hudson Gayville. I'm a water and sewer consultant for the city. I've been working in and around the city of Statesboro since the mid-90s. What I'd like to do today is kind of go through the presentation we did with the city of Statesboro, the city council meeting. I want to go through the existing water and sewer system for the city of Statesboro, and you'll find the city of Statesboro has a very robust water and sewer system. Generally, the city of Statesboro, 100% of the city of Statesboro's water comes from groundwater. The city has 8 groundwater meters, but I believe only 7 of them are active, and 6 elevated storage tanks. And you can see the groundwater wells are represented by a pump shape, and it's probably very difficult to see from out here, but we have a number of 6 elevated storage tanks, including one at the Grouchon Park. We have a number of groundwater wells, and we'll see later we have a couple more proposed in the future. Generally, the city's permit, groundwater withdrawal permit, is limited to 10 million gallons per day. But overall, the city currently is using about 7 million gallons per day on average. So right now, the city is within that permit. But there are some improvements the city would like to make in the future for the water system. The city's existing sewer system is composed of several lift stations and one central wastewater treatment plant. Generally, the city has 28 lift stations, including the two out at I-16 and 301. They have a number of lift stations within downtown area, and then they have the city has one large wastewater treatment plant which has a permitted capacity of 10 million gallons per day. The current flow at the wastewater treatment plant is approximately 5 million gallons per day. So capacity-wise, the treatment plant is in good shape on capacity. However, it was constructed in its current configuration approximately 30 years ago. So it is an aging infrastructure. If we take a look at some potential opportunities to expand the city's water capacity, or expand the city's water service capacity. Take a look at the opportunities for the city to expand the drinking water capacity. We see out at the Bruce Young Park, one of the primary goals in the near future will be to add a new groundwater withdrawal well. That would be approximately 21 million gallons per day. We're also taking a look at another potential groundwater well to service the northeastern part of the city. We're taking a look at looping the water system out at S&S Railroad Bed Road, where we're seeing a lot of development growth currently happening and a lot of activity. But we're also taking a look at planning for the future and developing a plan to extend water out 67 to 67 and I-16. And obviously that'll have to be a joint partnership between the city and the county. So that's one thing that we want to present to you. Eventually, if we extend water main out to I-16 along Highway 67, we want to put a groundwater well out there so that we can feed it from both ends, and also an elevated storage tank just like at 301 and I-16. Generally, the 10 million gallons per day of groundwater capacity is good for now, but with the amount of growth that we're expecting, the city is going to probably have to expand that groundwater withdrawal capacity. That will probably be done in conjunction with the new groundwater that's proposed. One major advantage to having having a new groundwater well out at I-16 at the Bruce Long Commerce Park is that currently the water is fed to the Commerce Park from groundwater wells that are more located towards town near the Beachy Tech area and the Gateway Industrial Park. Being able to feed the water main and feed the industrial park from the south side of I-16 will help spur development in that intersection. On the wastewater side, a key component of future growth will be upgrades to the lift stations along 301 from the Bruchon Industrial Park, Commerce Park, and also potentially a parallel force main. Currently, there's a 12-inch sewer force main, and that sewer force main has the capacity in that force main has been committed mainly to industrial development at the Bruchon Home Park. But we want to be able to serve, as Mr. King mentioned, we want to be able to serve future industrial development along Highway 301. And in order to do that, we'll have to make upgrades to those lift stations and also parallel force main. Also, we're looking at a new lift station in the near the S&S Railroad Bed area, near the Five Points, to help support development in that area. That will support residential development. And then looking at expansion down Highway 67, I think the city's newest lift station has just been completed across from the Kiwanis Fairgrounds. And what we'd like to do in the future is extend that sewer service out 67. And it may not be feasible to do it all at one time, but as development grows, it would be ideal to do it in phases, and that's certainly achievable as the development occurs. And then potentially in the near future, we'll be looking at a new wastewater treatment plant. The new wastewater treatment plant will not replace the existing wastewater treatment plant. It will be a smaller of up to 4 NGD wastewater treatment plant that would be located at Bird's Pond location. Bird's Pond location is an easy choice because flow can be diverted from either 67 or 301 to that wastewater treatment plant. But also, Bird's Pond is the location of the city's existing discharge from the existing wastewater treatment plant. So it should be an easy the easiest of the routes to get a new discharge permit because we won't be adding a new location to the discharge.
Before Chris sits down, any of the county commissioners have any questions on Chris as it relates to water and sewer. I do think it's important to stress as far as having that new well at the Bulloch Park. It's critical, not just from being able to serve that, but also from a fire protection standpoint, you got water right there. And that is an important component. We know we build things much safer these days, but when we have the municipal system, it needs to be robust so that we can ensure that we can protect the investments that are made. Questions?
The only comment I had, thank you, is that if you guys noticed that this is maybe the Tom's point, but the Highway 67 water main extension all the way out to 16 is about $7 million, which is less than just the local ARPA money from the county. So, I mean, certainly there are opportunities here to collaborate and work together to see if we can't keep this revenue here in our community. Thanks.
Mr. Charles, I might
be
saved
some time for you. We're here to listen.
Okay.
And we're gonna come back with our questions.
Okay.
Not come today.
On. Come on, Steve. Thank you, Mr. Lord. Steve Hyde.
Good afternoon, Councilman. Commissioners. I'm gonna talk a little bit about gas. We basically have the same issues with our gas system that we have with our water system. A little bit different. One of the gas system has one point. Which is located in Scriven County, about 4 miles outside of Sylvania. We pipe all that gas back into town. It doesn't matter if there's a round bypass and it goes out 301 to I-16 Industrial Park. As Mr. Finn mentioned, when Aspen first came in and they gave us the numbers, that they were required gas consumption. It was right up there at the very max that we could possibly provide at that site. And we were thinking, well, here we go, we won't have any gas capacity for the rest of the project. But as we negotiated our way through and found out, those numbers came down. It's a more reasonable amount, but it's still stressing our gas capacity on our system. And to improve that capacity, you have to go all the way back to the other end of the system and start increasing the size of the pipes. And you can see multiple page here has existing conditions and then upgrades. We haven't really got into dollars, figures in here much, so we kind of leave that. But it's a 3 or 4 step process to enlarge the size of our gas main so that we can increase. And the problem with that is the first steps will get you a lot of additional capacity into your system. The capacity increases really come as you increase that pipe size and you get toward the end of the system and you start getting the increases, but you've got to start doing it. So it's a multi-year, multi-phase process and quite a few millions of dollars to increase the size of that pipe and increase the capacity so that we can serve Bruce Young Park, Gateway Park, properties along 301 and whatever else might develop. Each 67 becomes a hotbed for growth. We'll need to build facilities in those areas. These slides here basically just cover the main line infrastructure, not the distribution system, just the high pressure lines. We have a 6-inch tap line that comes all the way into town, and this upgrade would probably sewer and that gas. It kind of comes down that order. And if you don't have the gas capacity to serve, sometimes you get checked right off the list and you don't go any further. So we want to be able to serve all these existing properties that we have so that we can fulfill those commitments that we've made through the years of those parks and then be able to supply for the future. So yeah, this is growth and it prepares this issue for us. And, I'd be happy to answer any questions that anybody has.
We did put some numbers to the water, the sewer, and the natural gas. And these numbers can be a large number and they could, they could gag and mag it, but we are trying to do that. We have to be realistic when we come back to you. We won't be talking these kinds of numbers. We would be talking about phasing in projects. So that we can make sure that one, we can afford to do what we need to do. But for certain, again, the priority would be on the industrial 301 corridor because, again, we don't want to miss an opportunity for the city or the county in that regard. As I said, we no decisions we need today, and we just simply need to have more staff and consulting work is needed. And then we'll prioritize the infrastructure needs, and that's why on your agenda, you see a next meeting will follow up in about 90 days. And we do recommend a follow-up joint work session with the Bulloch County Commission. And then we need to prepare a financial plan to fund the infrastructure, and then also look at conducting a rate analysis to see how we can handle debt payments. I want to jump to existing transportation infrastructure, and when the mayor started today, the mayor talked about us working together, and so the city and the county staff have been talking for several months now, trying to upgrade our comprehensive plan, so we're going to do that in a collaborative effort, and actually, Tom, I'm going to speak for you, Tom. But you've already prepared the RFQ, and at some point, I guess after the first of the year, that would go out for master planning for the city and county transportation. Transportation is really critical. and when we look around our community and the areas that are more difficult to get around, we don't want to miss out on opportunities and people not want to locate in an area because we haven't addressed the transportation infrastructure. And so this is really critical, and we appreciate Tom taking the leadership on that as well, among all the other stuff we've been doing in the last several months to get that out and working with the staff and our staff. We reviewed it, and we think we're prepared to move forward. The city does have money budgeted in order to help cover the cost of the plan, and I think easily Tom and myself and our staff, we recognize that this is not a cheap undertaking. I will say, Mr. Chairman and Mr. Mayor, we figure it's going to be somewhere north of maybe about $400,000 or so.
Up to you, because we probably hit the brakes.
Thank you, Tom. Well, just wanted to just make you aware, and you'll be hearing more about that as we move forward.
Can I make one comment?
Yes.
Thank you, Charles. That was very well done and explained. For those of you who were here when we did the last long-range transportation plan, I think a couple of things are going to be different. Use some transportation speak like when they do the GDOT The last plan we did not have what I, or what they call, and I call, constrained financial plan. So I think part of the expense, the additional expense that may go into this, is having a qualified firm, you know, develop something that we can use as sort of a rolling transportation CIP. That wasn't done the last time. They had a long list of potential projects, but and we tried, I think both the city and the county were able to accomplish a lot. There were a lot of state projects in there, likewise accomplished. But then we've also put in some add alternates into it that address issues that are more specific, perhaps, to the city of Statesboro or the county. So I'm hopeful, Charles, that maybe we'll get a base price of $250,000 to $300,000 to do that basic scope.
How tough is going to be negotiating?
and then I forget how many add alternates there were, 6 or 8 or 10. You know, we hope we can negotiate prices on that to stay within the budget, because they're very important things. So planning, not just transportation planning, but getting federal funding, you know, making sure that you cover such things as environmental justice, or maybe even looking at new technologies that seem foreign to us today. I mean, a year ago we were talking about planning, you know, something was coming, but we might need some form of intelligent transportation system. So I think it's a good opportunity. I really hope I can get this RFP out as early as next week. Or I'm talking with our purchasing manager about just some, a little bit of wordsmithing. But I feel confident that we can get it out on the market next week, and maybe by February or March we'll make a decision.
Thank you, Tom. The next item we want to speak about was the transportation issue. And I'm sorry, I'm not a planner. But I want to speak a minute about transportation from the standpoint, the city and the county, we have both projects in the Kiwanis Road, SNS Railroad. Council just approved the townhouse subdivision on the SNS Railroad maybe a year or so ago in the Aspen Heights area. They approved the development that was going to open up onto Kiwanis Road. And as we are talking about transportation, one of the items that I just want to bring to the county commissioner's attention would be the Burkhalter 67 corridor. About a month ago, the council annexed property at the corner. I think it was for Parkers. It's an old house that sits on Burkhalter and 67. And then on the other side would be where there's an extended stay hotel. Then the properties on the other side are in the county. But when you look at that area, that is where our housing development, housing exposure right now is going on. And we just simply want to say, if you go out Burkhalter and you come to that Burkhalter 67 intersection at the wrong time, it's a pinch point right now. And there are going to be more developments that are going to come. And we simply want to, we just recently got the T-SPLOS renewed by our citizens. But this area is so critical from a transportation standpoint, and we need to really look at how we can make some improvements so that people will not avoid that area. There are people that live out on off of Northside Drive that could come down into that area, but they avoid it right now because it is such a headache. And so we would just like to work with the county commission and say this is something that does need our very near future attention in order to keep people moving because as Tom talked about 2025 for the Hyundai plant, we anticipate that we're going to see some people moving into our community before, and this is an area that is positioned to see some pretty rapid growth. So that transportation issue that might inhibit people from not wanting to be in that area. So we just wanted to bring that to your attention. And at that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back my time.
Anyone else you want to call up? Well,
hello, Mr. Chairman.
Then, you know, I don't know about the other commissioners. I do want to make a comment. You know, we've done a lot of talking about Statesboro. We've done a lot of talking about the county. I just want everybody to understand that Statesboro is in the county. So with Brooklyn Portal Yellows, Register Portal, and I may have said portal twice, but we got a lot of hard work in front of us, and like the numbers that I saw, one of them was $50 million, one $10 million, one $11 million, $233,000, 14 cents. And you add all that up, it's like $80 million. And we haven't even gotten outside of Oakland. And but I think we have plenty of things to discuss. Coming up in our next meeting, I think it was February the 28th, unless it has changed. The county is fighting one, no, we aren't fighting, we're trying to work with. We have developed a steering committee. The names were not called out, but the, I guess, different types of people that live out in the county. And I know we're going to have some major trouble coming up. And because with the steering committee, when we meet, you know, we're all here talking about growth. But, and I've said this many times, growth may not come. Everybody knows it's coming, but it may not come. And here's the reason. If people don't want to sell their land, it's not coming. So we can talk about what we're going to do all day long. You know, I even thought one time about government consolidation. I know that's been brought up in the past, but it may be a possibility. I don't know, I just throw those two words out. And so I don't know how we're gonna work it all out, but we'll work it out some way we always have. And I've already said we'll have no public comments today. We might commit on y'all's grounds the next time or whatever. But if there's nothing else, then I'm going to ask for a motion to close this meeting. Okay. Right. And I apologize.
Oh, no problem. I do want to say this. I do want to echo Chairman Thompson's sentiment. As a community, we do have a lot of work to do. It's going to be a lot of tough decisions that's coming down the pipeline. But what I do want to share with you guys is that a lot of communities around the nation wish they were in the spot that we were in. I was out in Kansas City at the National Legal Cities Conference, and this project that's happening in our area was actually a topic of discussion among some peers there. And what I want to say to you guys is that some of the things that we're facing are some things that's been there for a while. When we talk about building out infrastructure, we easily understand the sewer and water side. We understand the transportation side. But a key piece of that is also housing. And what we're doing right now is that we're still recovering or dealing with the effects from 2007 and 2008. If you guys remember, that was the housing crisis. One of the things that happened out of that housing crisis is that a lot of developers stopped building homes. And so now we are in a space, and this is just not unique to us, it's across the country, where we're trying to rebound from that space and make sure we have adequate housing stock. And this is something that we're discussing not just within our community, but communities across the nation. So with that being said, I think we should, you know, be thankful for the fact that we do have a lot of opportunity. And there's other communities that are suffering. I heard some stories 2 weeks ago about some things that's happening in other communities, and that's not in Statesboro and Bulloch County. And we should be thankful for that. We are a very blessed community. And this is what I want to lend to the public. This is not a city decision or a county decision. This is an all of us decision. All of us have to work together. And what I mean to you guys is that it's better for us to plan our future than not. Because the growth, all of those things, that's a lot of potential. And it's better for us to plan our future than to be just a byproduct of what happens in the future. So with that being said, I want to thank the county commission, the staff, for allowing us to be a part of this great opportunity. And I just want to say to you that your staff has done a great job, and we really appreciate the hospitality.
Kirk, I believe you wanted to say something.
Yes, sir. First off, I want to commend our community managers in the county and the city for the presentations today. Just to echo, we do have a lot of work to do together. And in relation to that, being a member of this community planning group for our board, I'd like to call for a workshop on December the 13th. That would time that's best for the commissioners to discuss some things there and action that we may need to take. That's for our the county commission.
I guess the earlier end of the day for any meetings, or one in this room concerned because of Christmas lights, I'd say no later than 1:30, if possible.
I think we spoke possibly of earlier in the morning, that'd be 8:30, when we have our typical morning meetings, everybody make it. And just to reiterate what Commissioner Deal said, I know the chairman's wary. He's actually supposed to be on the committee, but he had some personal commitments. But it's a group of folks that include Georgia Southern, the Chamber, the City, Beach Tech, and others, Board of Education, who are thoughtfully trying to think through and make a collaborative effort to address the funding across the board. And I think we're, it's like a day and a half retreat or series of meetings. It really came out with some, in my opinion, compelling initiatives that I believe the county commission needs to be exposed to, and I think the city will be too, I believe, on the 20th. It's just, I couldn't guarantee how busy our meeting on the 20th would be, so I wanted to maybe a brief special meeting. It might not last more than an hour, and that way, total focus and nothing else on that.
Presentation.
If you like. I think it's important for the commission to hear, and in the interest of time, I think a special call meeting would be appropriate if everyone's in there.
And I'm out of here.
Is that 8:30 in the morning, the regular meeting time? 8:30,
9:30? Tentatively, we were discussing 8:30 on the 13th instead of the 20th.
Since we're using this room is likely booked on that day. So
it
we
is.
May need to throw out some tentative dates and pick one where this room is available.
Okay.
We can do that. Around the space. Unless we can find somewhere else to meet.
Yeah. Well, and I don't know that we need a big space, but we'll work that out.
Yeah,
but before the 20th, if we can.
Now, okay. We're going to step out on a limb here.
any witnesses to this, it'll be get out. Nobody said this.
It will get out.
But if you guys need a space, we can offer the city chamber for you guys to meet that day.
Okay.
Yeah.
That would be very gracious.
Okay. Don't tell them I'm working.
And please, my request, in fact, should not have made it, because in fact, it, you plan a meeting if when you can have it. I've got another major issue more so than Christmas light. I don't know what's gonna happen there, so if I can make any meetings, I will, I'm the county.
Sure.
And having said all of that, if there's nothing else, I need a motion to close this meeting.
So moved, Mr. Chairman. Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. All those in favor, show a hand. Unanimous approval. Do your thing.